Good morning and afternoon, everyone. This is Jean-Daniel Hostel, the president of the JavaCast Forum, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this fourth webinar from the JavaCast Forum 2021 webinar series. I hope you enjoyed the previous presentations, and if not, please feel free to watch them on replay on the JavaCast Forum site. Today's topic is a presentation from Jill Bernabe on global platform vision of the secure element security, with a preview of several application programming interfaces that Global Platform recently released as technical documents. Global Platform technologies have always complemented the billions of JavaCard devices deployed over the past 25 years. And it's very likely that the new API presented in this webinar will do so in the near future. Jill Bernabe is Global Platform Technical Director, as well as Technical Advisor for the Standardization and Technology Department at Thales, Digital Identity and Security. In this role, he supports Thales Marketing and Product Group to deploy trusted and convenient digital services. Jill was elected as Global Platform Technical Director in 2005 and has ever since driven forward the development of Global Platform specification to deploy secure services. Jill also acts as Global Platform Central Technical Liaison Point, coordinating the Secure Element Technical Committee, the Trusted Execution Environment Committee, and the Trusted Platform Services Committee, as well as the various task forces. We will answer your question at the end of the presentation. You can enter them in the chat box whenever you fit, but we will also open the microphone at the end of the presentation so that you will be able also to ask directly the question to Jill. Please also note that you will receive the link to the recorded presentation shortly after the meeting by mail. Without any other delay, please, Jill, the desk is yours.
Thank you, Jean-Daniel. And thank you to all the attendees today. I'm very happy to be there and to share with you some of the technical development that the Global Platform has done in the last months related to secure element device integration. As you know, Global Platform and all the industry related to smart card has been moving in the last 20 years from smart card to elements that are soldered or integrated or added into device. And this move is accelerating currently. I will share a few of the actions that we have made to make it more simple on this topic. And I would like to go to three type of view that that we have. First of all, something related to the hardware. There is a big trend regarding the embedding, solding security element or integrated secure element. So I will go on this, I will say more the hardware, low layer part of the stack. I will go then about a more global vision about how to provide security services into the device. And then I will go to the, what we call the device trusted architecture. And just to finish, something regarding to the user authentication and biometric authentication, just to give you different view of what doesn't mean integrating a secure element into a device and how we can optimize this or make it more simple. So let's start by the embedding and integrating part. So again, you have here some kind of trend. We start from a card, and I put a finger here, so you see the size of the card that you have in your pocket because it's a banking card, or it's an ID card, or it's a driving license card. You know this format, which is very good to take on hand and to use it. There is an integration into the device, and typically here I took the example on the finger in the middle of the size of one embedded SIM as an example. So it's one of the formats that are used today to embed secure element. And Now we are talking about integrated secure elements. So if you take the chipset that are currently produced from big chipset manufacturers, we are now able to integrate one specific core within this multi-core chipset to provide security services. So this is a trend that we are following. And of course, one of the big value of embedding secure element is that today we are using certain protocols that are used by readers by in contact mode or used by antenna in the contactless mode. And this was a long journey to be able to have something standardized that you can take your credit card and to put to any of the MPOS or POS reader today, it works. This is based on the ISO standard, but you don't have this kind of environment when you are embedding the secure element into device. And here on this market, you are using a protocol and bus that are widely deployed. This is why we have created a new specification, which is APDU transport over SPI IS2C. The objective is to be able to help the usage of SPI and IS2C, that are two worldwide deployed interfaces into devices, and to continue to use APDU. So it was our choice. Most of the applications today, typically the banking application, the ID application, the driving license application are based on APDU. And our intent here was to use new protocols, but with the same, I would say, application protocol. So this specification provides today two support, the SPI. So here the secure element is a slave, like in today, huh? You know that the smart card is really the receiver of the command. And we have clarified what to put on the serial clock, on the master in, master out, that are the specificities of the SPI. And the SPI interface is used for half duplex communication. But we have also in the same document the clarification and the standardization about usage of IS2C. So that explains again how the device is talking to the secure element and are able to exchange that. So the specification has been published. We plan to start interoperability testing to again simplify and optimize the integration of secure element using SPI or IS2C beginning of next year. So this is something that that we are working on. We have been a little delay on this effort because of the COVID, but we will soon restart all the tests. It was difficult to do this kind of test remotely. So we hope that we will be able to have a device and secure element, embedded secure element ready beginning next year. So, voilà, this is typically something that was very important for the device manufacturer to be able to understand what they need to implement in their device, and then after to be able to locate close to their device the secure element. Another trend, as I said, is the integration of secure element into the chipset. So you know that most of the smartphones we are using are multi-core. The objective of this technology and this integration is really to have a specific core that we call a tamper-resistant element that will be able to provide within the chipset similar services that the secure element is doing today on the device that I have introduced just before. So the specificity of integrating a secure element within a chipset is that the memory is not the same. So when you switch off the chipset, all the memory disappear. And then we need to have a way to load the memory when you are switching on and store the memory when you are switching back. So this is why we need to have one specific tool that is not needed within the world of the embedded secure element or secure element. And we call it Open Firmware Loader. So it's really a possibility to load the entire memory of the tamper resistant element within the chipset. The second part of this technology is what we call the virtual primary platform. Today, when you develop an OS for a chipset for an embedded secure element or for a smart card, then we have a long discussion and a long time relationship with the chipset manufacturer, and we know all the entry points that we need. Here, the idea was to develop some kind of hardware abstraction layer to be able to develop the OS and to be able to load later on the OS within the chipset and to have some standardized hardware abstraction layer. Let me give you a few details about the Open Firmware Loader. So again, the Open Firmware Loader explains that you are able to create an image. So this image has a specific format. And then, so this is creation image is a step one. Then after you can create one image for billions of devices, you need to adapt the image for a specific device. So this is possible. So what we call the step three, which is a binding. And then after you have an agent within the device and that will be able to take this image, which is a file, and to be able to load it within the device. Voilà, so this is a way to personalize the secure element and to create a specific image that embed all the application and to load it within the chipset, which is within the integrated secure element. So again, we call that an open firmware loader to be able to provide this personalization effort that is needed. Because you know that the devices are created by billion, and when the device that you purchase later on it's produced, they don't know which banking card you want or which driver license you want. So there is a need to later on load all the information related to your country, your environment, your application, etc. And the Open Firmware Loader helps for that. When the image is loaded, of course, after the integrated secure element will manage locally the backup and restore at each switch on, switch off. Let me give you a few details about the virtual primary platform. So the virtual primary platform embed four documents. First of all, the firmware format. So here you see that there is a possibility to clarify what needs to be created within this format, how to describe the application, the memory, the data, everything, firmware format. Of course, there is the extension, an adaptation on board of this Open Firmware Loader. But the main document, it's the concept and interface. This explains the responsibility, role and responsibility of the chipset, which is here on the left and the bottom of the slide. What the hardware needs to do and what kind of API the hardware needs to provide to an OS. Here, the OS is represented as an executable image that will embed, again, the application and the high-level OS. So this is where you will find the Java card application, the Java card OS, the global platform OS, and all the application on the executable image. And DPP explain the role and responsibility between this integrated OS and the hardware. Of course, the integrated OS needs access to the baseband, need access to, and this is the blue link. So we have created a network protocol to be able to explain how the executable image and so the OS of the secure element will be able to open a connection with the baseband, with the memory, with the reader, with the modem with a fingerprint sensor, and how they will be able to get information, retrieve information. Of course, this will be created in a way that when you switch off the device, automatically when you will switch on the device and you will reload the OS within the integrated secure element, then you will be able to have all this connection open. So voilà, this is the four documents. The main one is the concept interface that are very important, that explain, again, the role and responsibilities, and also the network protocol that allows the integrated OS to be able to open connections. Just for your information, the Open Firmware Loader and the Virtual Primary Platform technology is already integrated within the ETSI Smart Secure Platform. I put here the references of the document. We are finalizing V2.0 of the VPP that is directly related to the effort of ETSI to integrate this technology into the new smart secure platform technology of ETSI. And I think the collaboration went very, very well. And now you have both the basic technology of global platform to create any kind of secure element, but also the extension that ETSI has created to support the 5G and other use cases that ETSI is working on. Voilà, so this is the first part of my presentation to explain what we are doing to support the embedding and the integrating of secure element into the device. But if you go on the device itself, outside of the hardware impact, there is a lot of concern regarding how the device is creating the trust within the device and how to integrate different technology that are here. So what we are really pushing today within the device world is to have a device trust hierarchy that starts with something which is very, very secure and that provide what some others are calling a root of trust. And from this root of trust, you need to create different hierarchies of trust chain, from the keys of the root of trust to, first of all, the device OS, because the device OS needs to boot, needs to have the primary element of security, and then slowly by slowly go to application. Both applications will be the one that will be connecting to the external world through internet to service provider platform. So this root of trust and this chain of trust, this is really the core of the technology of Cloud Platform, because we were working on root of trust, both for the secure element and both for the TEE, with different type of services. But it was very, very important to explain that to a wide audience, because today in the IoT world, we are talking a lot with device manufacturer. They were doing, I would say, fridge. And today they are doing connected fridge. And of course, they don't have the knowledge of 20 years history of managing secure services. So this device trust hierarchy, based on secure element, we have decided to make it more simple to use. And we have created what we call a device trust architecture to really try to offer services at each level of the chain within the device. So we are looking to provide services for the boot from the root of trust, of course. And then after, we are looking what kind of API we need to provide for the device OS, and of course, later on the application. This is very, very important because, again, when you are using a secure element, when you are using an embedded secure element, when you are using a TEE, you have a root of trust. So it's very, very important for the device manufacturer to optimize the presence of this root of trust to create the trust within the device. So this will produce, of course, as an API, And you see in this, I will say, very simplified devices, the TPS API in the middle. So the TPS API, this is the new type of services that will be implemented into a secure component. So depending of which secure component you will use, you will still use the same TPS API. So what we call secure component, it's the hardware and firmware and application. So it can be as a form of a very high secure, tamper resistant secure element, as we are discussing today. Within Global Platform, we have also TE. We are looking now for MCU. So we have different type of secure component with different type of level of security, of course, depending of the device and market. But the secure component will implement typically a key store. This is the primary service that needs to be provided. We need to provide also attestation. This is very important in the connected world. And of course, we plan to have multiple other digital services developed and deployed as applet. So this DPS API is really the baseline for the trust within the device. And then the stack, the communication stack, typically the system services, will be able to use it. We are looking towards IoT devices. So of course, we are working with the cloud service API that needs to store keys, that needs to have attestation, extra, extra, to use the TPS API. And we hope to provide very soon all the basic services to accelerate the deployment of trustworthy devices thanks to this Trusted Platform Service API. So the value of the Trusted Platform Service on Secure Element is that, of course, the secure element will be embedded within the device with specific keys and pre-installed application. This is very important. There is a lot of fears today on the market because device may be produced in markets where you don't have control. And typically here, you can put all your secret and all the key trusted element within the secure element and to provide that to the device manufacturer. So the device manufacturer will solve, integrate the secure element, but with specific applet, specific keys. In the Android world, the Open Mobile API are widely deployed. All the Android devices are supporting Open Mobile API. Inside, you have Access Control Enforcer. So to the high level within the device, the integration is already done. And this is something that we want to provide also outside of the Android world. We want to provide that in any kind of devices and to be able to have this stack. We are with the secure element, with the Open Mobile API that provide a standard mechanism to communicate with the SE and of course to create these TPS agents to be able to have the attestation API, key store APIs, etc., etc. So we plan to have this ready. The key store API are more or less finalized. The attestation API are ongoing. And this will be very a key stone to provide the device trust architecture that we plan to deploy within the device world. And to accelerate this trend, because we know that in the IoT world, we are talking with people that are looking more on open source and on the world specification. If you go to the global platform GitHub environment, you will see that we are starting reference implementation of this TPS API. And today we have decided to use one technology which is widely used in IoT, which is the technology of related to CBOR, which is a binary implementation of JSON. So we have now starting the first basic tools for CBOR, for COSE, and for CDDL. And soon we will have the implementation of the attestation API and the KeyStore API. So if you are taking the right secure element, you will be able to plug and play all the source code, the secure element, and to have within your device a full stack there where all the services, secure services, are connected with a root of trust. Let me now go to the last part of my presentation and to talk about the market. So today, I would say last year, 35% of the smartphone was already with the embedded secure element. We expect this to grow by 50% by 2025. So this is already something that as soon you are using a smartphone, which medium or high level, you have a secure element. So we have now a lot of usage of the embedded secure element within smartphone. And you see that we are talking about a lot of millions of units. Eh? By 2024, we are talking about more than 400 million of devices. So this is a big field, and of course, the use cases to use it are growing and growing. And there is a second trend, which is the biometric authentication on those devices. And as you see, the usage of biometric to authenticate, the usage of the to unlock the device are growing. And again, by 2024, we see a strong usage of biometric for authentication. So definitely, lot of devices are today using the secure element to provide high level of biometric recognition and authentication and identification. And we have a lot of demand from the service provider that say that, okay, there is certainly in the pocket of my customer a smartphone with biometric authentication, secure biometric authentication based on the secure element. I would like to use it. So today, service providers are very, very interested to use it because they will reduce the risk management. Device manufacturer, of course, they try to use that because it's very fun and very frictionless. But in the middle, you have sensors, you have different type of biometrics, you have more and more device architecture, etc. So there is a need to standardize, to make it more simple, this chain from the service provider to the end user. And there is, I would say on the right, the biometric system that will be moving. The service provider is deploying in device application. The device application is using a secure element application. And what we have decided is to look what we can do to make the secure application the more independent possible from the biometric system. So this is really the last step. So here I'm using the view of EMVCO. EMVCO has integrated this vision from what they call the consumer device cardholder verification method to be able to put in place on risk management. Risk management to know that if you are authenticated inside the device with nothing or with something that I know, so a PIN, a pattern, a password, or something what I am with biometric. So they are starting to put in place all the risk management related to that. And they need to have clear and points about what kind of biometric is used by my end user on this device. So we have worked with EMVCO, and really the objective here, it's to let the service provider to focus on risk management, to define their level of usage, what they trust, what they don't trust. Each service provider may have different view, And we think that the device manufacturer is here to really focus on the integration of the biometric subsystem. And we need to help them to connect this biometric subsystem to the secure element. So we have created what we call the broker interface. So payment application, to talk about EMVCO, but any kind of application located within the embedded secure element will be able to ask to a specific application, which is called the broker interface, what are the biometric subsystems available within the device and what are the level. This broker application, in fact, is really the gateway between the secure element world and the device world. So if I'm taking this, you see the broker application is really within the secure element, is developed by the device manufacturer. And the device manufacturer will develop the broker application to use the authenticator application inside the device. It can be an authenticator like the camera, it can be within the TEE, it can be something more secure. But the broker application will be developed by the device manufacturer to connect to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 authenticator application that are within the device. Means that the application one of the bank, of the service provider, or application three will be able to use within the secure element APIs to access to the broker application. And they will ask the broker application, okay, what are the biometric system available? What are the level? When the end user has connected onto this? How many times the PIN has been entered? How many times the fingerprint has been entered, extra, extra. So now with this broker application, the banks, the service provider, the government are able to develop an application without knowing the details of the implementation of the authenticator application within the device. They will be able to test that in their labs and deploy to any kind of device that are using an embedded secure element with the broker application. Voilà, so this is really the three different points I wanted to present today to be able to show the different activities that we have within Global Platform to help the integration of secure element application into the device. So I wanted to, again, back to the figure that I have shared. We are not talking about something tomorrow or after tomorrow. We are talking about today. Most of the point that I have presented today are answering to a trend into the market, where people are looking for standardization just to make it more simple. We are not at all on the first yearly deployment or the first tentative. We are here to really manage the mass market. And mass market, we need to have standards to reduce the price and to deploy better and more quickly all this technology, both on the hardware level, again, by the SPI, the S2C, to have all these tools available on this compliance to be sure that everybody is able to test the API. Or in anti-integration, maybe this is the point where it's more at the edge of the innovation because it's not a mass market approach. Nevertheless, this is quite complex and we hope that VPP will help secure element OS developer and hardware to develop better solutions and to give birth of good and optimized solution. And then after, something which is very important, authentication into the device with the secure element and how the high-level secure application are able to use authenticator. We have, of course, a strong collaboration with FIDO on that. FIDO is one of the possible authentication mechanisms. And I will announce next week in my second presentation two details about some result of the collaboration with FIDO. But again, IEVECO is working on that, a lot of activities. In Europe, we are talking a lot about the mobile wallet, so mobile ID wallet. So there is a lot of value to use this standardized technology to really accelerate and to make it more simple and more really easy to deploy and to use high-level secure services from Secure Element. Voilà, that was my presentation for today. And Jean-Daniel, I don't know if there is some questions.
Very interesting. Thank you, Gilles, for this presentation. No question in the chat. We can open the microphone if you have a question to ask to Gilles. While people are thinking about the question, I have one myself. You described the broker application, you know, for the biometrics. We had a webinar, the last one, I think, was also on the I3C bus, and where the secure element can also be a host. So do you foresee that at some point the biometric devices would be connected to the secure element, and what will happen then with the broker application?
So definitely, what we have tried to solve with the first I2C is to stay with the current model of the usage of the secure element and secure element application, where the secure element is, expecting some command from the device. But the integration and even more the integration of secure element make it this model not enough to answer to some questions. And typically, if you are taking the biometric, everything starts by the user that it's putting his finger on the sensor, and then the sensor talk to the secure element, and the secure element needs to talk to application. So here the secure element needs to be able to wake up some application into the device, and definitely these use cases are growing. The support of I3C will definitely be able to accelerate this development. For Global Platform, in fact, the support of I3C is needed and maybe enough to be able to support new use cases where the secure element will be more the one to ask something for the device and to change the current, receiver, sender model of the secure element. So definitely, yes, within the device, we see that there is some potential new use cases where the secure element will be sending by its own some commands to the device application.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any questions from the virtual room? Please feel free to open your mic. I have another one myself. Okay, you describe, you know, the new VPP OFL and what's happening is that before there was a physical boundary, you know, between the secure element and the host, a reader or physical interface. Now that it's really embedded and even integrated, do you think what's the likeliness of an adoption of the what you described in your presentation? Because in a sense, they could integrate and do whatever they would. So what would be the incentive? Is it interoperability or something else?
So in fact, the value of Global Platform with the API is to allow specific services to deploy applications. If you don't have an API, it's very difficult for a market such as a bank, such as a mobile driving license world, ID, loyalty, and extra to invest on this technology. So The trend of integration of core and secure core is here. The technology is here, but to be able to answer to the service provider, you must have applications. You must have APIs. So typically, this is where we are today. The technology is here. I mean, integration of the secure element within chipset. But if we don't find the right level of API, market will not invest. And today, you have a lot of market using the secure element and the embedded secure element. It's here. It takes 2, 3, 4, 5, depending of the difficulties to deploy. Needs a lot of investment. And we reach a certain level of value. Embedded secure element today are providing, again, by the key management extra, by the delivery process, by the fact that you may have the same application into a smart card and into the embedded secure element, provide a certain level of services. The integrated technology needs to find its own way. And the API, it's a way to, again, explain to new users how they can use this technology. And then I foresee within 2, 3 years that some new market or some new use cases, if you don't want to call it market, will start to look this technology to understand the security, to understand the pros and cons of the technology, and then we'll be able to develop the next version of applications that we will certainly use in our smartphone within 2, 3 years. So we are really here to help service provider to look the technology, to start to use it, to understand, to create new use cases. And then this will be available in your pocket, certainly within 2, 3 years.
Thank you. We have a question from Renish Poshia. Is there any specifications for the broker applet?
So, yes. This is the specification that you can look on. If you go to the globalplatform.org website, you will see that. So the broker application, in fact, specification explain what are the services that the broker application needs to provide. Okay, so let me back to this second slide. So the broker application is within so the broker application is here. Okay. Oh, completely not where I want. Sorry. So the broker application, to answer to your question, is part of the Java Card application and Java Card OS. The broker application specification explains the API that you must support to be able to really provide these services. After the code of the broker application, this is not described. This is really the code to explain how to use external services. But the API here that you must provide if you develop a broker application are completely standardized within Global Platform. I hope that I have answered your question.
Thank you, Gilles. By the way, any interoperability test will be done with this broker application? Is there some test plan or something like this?
Today, it's of course one day we'll have some test plan, but we have other API that are in the queue for beginning next year. So don't expect compliance services before H2 2022 for this one, because our workload is quite important on the beginning of next year.
So I have a throwback question from Renish, who now asks why the broker application is not part of the Java Card OS.
But there is no need to develop application within the Java Card OS, because typically Java Card is used in smart card. Smart card, you may not need a broker application. Java Card is used in SIM card, you may not need broker application. So if each and every services that we need are developed as part of the JavaCard OS, JavaCard will have billions of applications. This is the value of the global platform APIs to allow people to develop additional services and to provide services within a global platform JavaCard secure element. All the additional services must be developed by service provider or by the device manufacturer. If you force the device manufacturer to load their code into the OS, you force the device manufacturer to understand how JavaCard is created, how global platform is created, how to provide that. And this is very, very too complex for a device manufacturer. This is not the intent. JavaCard provide the runtime environment. Global platform provide all the security services, the way to load application, to connect with the external world, to manage multiple actors, banks, government, and extra. And on top of that, a bank, a government, a device manufacturer are able to develop applications using the JavaCard API or the Global Platform API.
Thank you. Do you have any other question, please? Feel free. Okay, looks like everything was pretty much clear. Thank you again, Gilles, for this very interesting presentation. I remind you it has been recorded and will be available. You will receive the link and the material shortly. And also, I think there's plenty of links in the presentation to Global Platform website where you will be able to look specifically to the different APIs and other great material. Thank you, Gilles. Yes. Thank you, everyone. And please keep posted for the next webinars in the series. We have, I think, a few interesting presentations coming up next week. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye-bye.